if you write the equation from the general set of equations we wrote for multi-degree freedom, for two-degree freedom system, if you eliminate damping, this is what you end up with. You get M1 U1 double dot plus K1 plus K2 U minus K2 U2, U2 equal to zero. Then you have M2 U2 double dot plus minus K2 U1 plus K2 U2 is equal to zero. This is the two equations of motion that you get, right? So let's take a look at these two equations. As we had seen before, these are two simultaneous linear homogeneous differential equations. And in order to solve for these equations, there are several approaches. And one which is the easier one, very similar to single degree of freedom systems, we will assume that the solution to these equations will be, he just lost 5 points.
Negative 5.
Right. So U2 is A2 sine omega t, okay? Substitute these back into the equation in order to find the amplitudes and the frequencies, right? So let's do that. If you substitute this, these two there, you get what? You get M1, take the second derivative of this, would be minus omega squared A1 sine omega t, right? Plus K1 plus K2 times A1 sine omega t minus K2 A2 sine omega t is equal to zero, okay? The second one you have M2 times minus omega, okay? I have omega 2 here, minus omega squared A2 minus K2 A1 sine omega t plus K2 A sine omega t is equal to zero. Sine omega t is not zero, obviously, right? So we'll just divide these by sine omega t. So simplified a little bit, what you get is this. You get minus omega squared M1 plus K1 plus K2 times A1, right? And then minus K2 A2 is equal to zero. Then you have minus omega squared M2 A2. Minus K2 A1 plus K2 A2 is equal to zero. So what is this equation? This equation is supposed to give you the information that you need to find omegas and A1 and A2s, right? This is a homogeneous set of simultaneous set of equations. And as you know, if you have a homogeneous set of simultaneous equations, remember from linear algebra, I'm sure all of you have taken linear algebra, right? So you remember vividly everything about matrices and all that good stuff, right? But assuming that you don't remember, and I hope that doesn't come as an insult if I tell you you don't remember, but anyway, this equation will have solution only and only if the determinant of the coefficient is zero. Why is that? Because for basically the linear homogeneous set of equations, which is in general like this, A1 x1 plus A2 x2 is equal to zero, A2 X, I'm sorry, B1, X1 plus B2, X2 is equal to zero. Let's say you want to find X1, using, say, Cramer's rule, right? Is what? The numerator would be a determinant, which the first column is the right-hand side, the second column are the coefficient of this guy, and the denominator would be the A1, A2, B1, B2, right? This is zero, right? So these two variables either have a trivial solution, means x1 and x2 is zero. For a non-trivial solution to exist, the condition is that this has to be zero. So you get 0/0, which is not zero, means a value, right? Remember L'Hopital's rule. So the condition for a set of homogeneous equation to have an answer is that the determinant of the coefficients to be zero. That means the determinant of minus omega squared m1 plus k1 plus k2 minus k2 minus omega squared m2 minus, actually, I reversed those, so it would be minus k2, okay, minus omega squared m2 plus k2. This determinant has to be zero. What is this determinant? This determinant consists of these numbers that are part of the parameters defining the system or associated to degree of freedom system. So this is a function of frequency. We show this function like this. It's a function of omega, and we call that frequency equation. That is, this is a quadratic equation in terms of omega squared, solution of which would give you the two frequencies corresponding to this 2 degree of freedom system, okay? So you just expand this determinant, right? This times that minus this times that, you get that quadratic equation, solve that quadratic equation. So do you want me to write it down? I will, that's okay. M1 plus K1 plus K2, right? Times negative omega squared M2 plus K2 minus K2 times K2. So K2 squared is equal to zero, okay? So you solve that, and what it will give you is basically something like this. Would be a quadratic equation. If you solve for the roots of those equations, those two roots would be this. Omega 1 and 2 would be 1 over k1 plus k2 divided by m1 plus k2 over m2 minus and plus 1/4 of K1 plus K2 over M1 plus K2 over M2 squared minus K1, K2 divided by M1, M2. These are the roots of this equation. These roots are the frequencies associated with those degrees of freedom, okay? So now in order to solve for A1 and A2, you need to substitute back into the equation. But again, when you have a homogeneous set of equations, these two are not independent. In other words, you can use only one of these two equations and divide that by one of those variables, and you're only able to find the ratio of those two variables. In other words, the relative value of those variables, not the actual value. So you substitute these back into those equations. So for, say, omega 1, you find 1A2 over A1. For omega 2, you find another A2 over A1. The common approach, or the customary approach, is that we usually set A1 is equal to 1. In other words, you normalize this with respect to one of these variables. And you plot this qualitative values. For instance, this is A1 equal to 1. In other words, if this moves in a certain direction, this is this. And the value of A2 would be something here or something here, whatever. So you get the qualitative shape. We call these mode shapes. So this is mode shape number 1. This is mode shape number 2. Or, you know, commonly we call them mode 1 and mode 2. Okay? So each frequency shows how that structure is going to deform as basically is oscillating with that frequency. For a 2 degree of freedom system, we have two frequencies. Those are the natural frequencies of the system. The first frequency, we call that fundamental frequency. And the higher frequencies correspond to higher modes. For instance, if you have a beam like this, okay, the first mode is something like this. The second mode would be something like this. Okay? So, in other words, this is mass 1, this is mass 2. Okay? But let's do an example problem to see this in much more meaningful and quantitative way. Any questions? No? So let me do an example. And by doing that example, you now will have all the tools that you need to complete your exam. So let's look at a simple example. This example is a two-story building, shear building. So we have the weight of these two being W1 and W2. So column 1 is column 2. So we know that as this oscillates, obviously, these two go through the same deformation. So total stiffness on the first floor will be, since these are parallel, will be a summation of these two. And this would be summation of those two. So the values given are as follows. Let's assume W1 and W2 are equal, so let's call that W. I of the first column is twice the area moment of the other column, so let's call that 1 to I. Now I2 is I. Length of the first column would be twice the length of the second column. Let's call that L. And the stiffness of the first column obviously is what? This K1 would be 2 times 12 EI over L cubed. So K2 would be K1 over 2. Given those values for I and E. So these are the values that we have. So we have the equation of motion. Just substitute these back into that equation, and you end up with this equation. U1 double dot plus 3BU1 minus BU2 is equal to 0. U2 double dot plus BU2 minus BU1 is equal to 0, where B is 12 EI G over W L Q. Okay. So those are the equations of motion. So what did we say? Now we need to substitute, I mean basically assume U1 and U2 are harmonic functions that we had before. Substitute those into these equations. So in other words, let's say is at A1 sine omega t, U2 is A2 sine omega t. Set up the equation A1 and A2, and you set the determinant of the coefficients equal to 0. Determinant of those coefficients would be negative omega squared plus 3b minus b minus b minus square root 2 plus b is equal to 0. Okay? So solve for the roots. If you set up your quadratic equation, it would be omega 4 minus 4b omega 2 plus 2b squared is equal to 0. So omega 2 would be 0.586b and 3.414b. Those are omega 1s and omega 2s, okay? Or the square omega. So these are the two. Let's say if you assume 12 EI G over W L squared, or actually not that, just the G EI over W L 3. If I consider this to be 2, just a number, omega 1 comes out to be 3.75 radians per second. Omega 2 comes out to be 9.1 radians per second. Just to show you, at least numerically, that there are two, basically equal roots. In other words, although this is in terms of omega 4, which leads to omega 2, if you find omega 1 and omega 2, you'll see that you have basically the same value. So these are the two values for omega, right? So as the next step, I need to substitute these back into the equation that have these coefficients in order to find A1 and A2. But as I said, you can use only one of those two equations because these equations are not independent. So I'm going to consider only one of these equations. And that equation would be this. The first equation would look like this. A1 omega squared minus plus 3b, I think negative, 3b A1 minus b A2 is equal to 0. So I will only consider the first equation. These two equations are not independent. I said you consider one of them and divide that by one of the variables. So I will divide this by A1. So what you get is 3 minus omega squared plus 3b minus b A2 over A1 is equal to 0. So we try to find A2 over A1. So if you do that, this is what you get. A2 will be minus omega squared plus 3b divided by ba1. And as I said, it is customary that you consider a1 is equal to 1 and find a2 in terms of that assumed value, which we call a normalized values. So for omega 1 squared, where you had 0.586b, omega 2 squared was 3.414b, okay? A1, we said 1 for each case, A1 is equal to 1, and you find A2. In this case, you find A2 to be 2.414. Here, A2 is negative 0.414, okay? So these are the frequencies, natural frequencies, and these are the shape corresponding to each frequency, which we call them a mode shape. If you plot this one, you see that for the shape corresponding to frequency one would be like this. If this mass moves one unit this way, the other mass would move 2.414. So both masses move in the same direction. For this case, with mass one moves one unit, the other mass moves negative 0.414. So the masses actually oscillate in the opposite direction. Mass one goes this way, the other one goes like that, or vice versa. There's something peculiar about these mode shapes, and that is, if you look at this deformation, see that there is a point here along the structure that does not move, stays stationary. We call this a node. So node is a point where the structure experiences zero deformation, which is great. Imagine if you put a soft support there. It's not subjected to any force, no dynamic force, no displacement, no stresses, no strains, right? So, and of course, the number of nodal points depends on what mode of vibration you're considering. The higher the modes, the more the nodal points you'll have, okay? So that's it. This is basically the procedure for the analysis, what we call the analysis of a 2-degree of freedom system. So let me just summarize what we did, which is very easy, right? Step one. So this is a summary of what we did. I want to summarize that, right? One, you set up equations of motion, right? Step two, consider a solution of type ui is ai sine omega t. Of course, I is 1 and 2 in this case, okay? Substitute this into 1, right? Equation 1. So once you substitute that, you get an equation in terms of A1 and A2. Then you consider the determinant of coefficients for two. After you substitute this one into this, you get an equation in terms of A1 and A2 and omega. Consider the determinant of the coefficient. This is going to be the frequency equation. Okay? So you find the roots of this quadratic equation. Those will be the frequencies of the system. Okay. Now, substitute these roots into equation 2, or equation that basically the variables are A1 and A2 resulting from the substitution, okay? And for each value of omega, find the corresponding relative deformed shapes. That is to say, A2 over A1. You need to note that you can use only one of those equations for A1, A2, okay? Because they are not independent, okay? And the last step is just plot A2, A1. Of course, A1 is taken as 1, okay? For each omega. These are called mode shapes. So these are the mode shapes. These were the frequencies, or the natural frequencies of the system. So that's basically the procedure to solve any two-degree of freedom system, for that matter, of course, multi-degree of freedom system. But we'll get to that in more details. Okay, any questions? Okay, if not, let me just continue, at least lay the foundation for generalizing this approach for multi-degree of freedom systems. And I know that now that you know what's going to be needed for your final exam, you're going to go through a period of what they call relaxation or indifference, whatever you want to call that, in a polite way. I don't care, something like that. No. But anyway, let's at least cover something for those of you who are, as I said, going to have a passion about vibration. Okay, so I'm just going to generalize this, see how easy it is. That multi-degree freedom system is just going to follow naturally, okay? So this is what we do. Let's go back to, so I'm gonna now write this as multi-degree of freedom analysis. We set up the equation of motions in matrix form, right? So this was, we are talking about, of course, undamped free vibration, right? So this was the equation of motion, right? If you have a free, undamped vibration, okay? This was the mass matrix, this was the stiffness matrix, this was the vector of displacements. Okay? Now, if you consider this, that's what we did. I mean, follow those steps. So this was the question, I mean, step number one. We said that step number two is we consider a solution of this type. So what I would call this, actually I would call that phi sub I sine omega t. Instead of ai, I'm just going to call that phi sub I. Doesn't matter. So you substitute this into that equation, okay? And then, so substitute into one, right? And now find the determinant of those coefficients, set it equal to zero. If you do this, substitute into that equation, take a second derivative and so on, you'll see this is what you will get. You get k minus omega squared m, okay? This is basically times, I show it like this and I will tell you what it is equal to zero, okay? This is that A1, A2, right? If you remember from matrix algebra, especially if I write it like this, you had something like this. Okay? I think that's what you had, at least. Do you remember what you called this equation? Any of you remember vaguely? Those of you who really like matrix analysis, this was called eigenvalue equation. Okay? So you can write this in a different form, identical to that, if you pre-multiply by the inverse of the mass matrix, you get basically M inverse K times this is equal to, take this to the right hand side, would be omega squared K times phi sub I. This is the same as that one, doesn't matter. Both are the same, called eigenvalue, or the, basically these are eigenfunctions, another name for that. So phi sub I is basically something like this, okay, is 1i phi 2i. This number corresponds to the degree of freedom. This number corresponds to frequency. In other words, phi 1, 1 is the shape for degree of freedom 1 corresponding to most frequency 1. And 2, 1 corresponds to the degree of freedom 2 to subject to the frequency 2. In other words, for a 2 degree of freedom system, this is 1, 1, phi 2, 1, okay? Which are the two that we plotted, okay? In other words, this is this, okay? For corresponding for omega 1. Omega 2, this would be phi 2, 1, and phi 2, 2, which was this one that we plotted, okay? But that's usually the notation we use in general, okay? What we call this, okay, We call these, as I said, the mode shapes or eigenvectors. Eigenvectors or mode shapes. Omegas are called eigenvalues. Eigenvalues, eigenvectors. So we'll pick up from here. But that's just the extension to multi-degree of freedom systems.